Welcome, everyone. Bienvenidos. My name is Armando Alvarez, here with you from the city of Riverside in California. I will act as commentator in this Latin American Perspectives podcast. Today, we are focusing our attention on our May 2013 issue of Latin American Perspectives, titled Latin America's Radical Left in Power, Complexities and Challenges in the 21st Century. A lot has changed in governments adopting socialism, and we have two guests to elaborate more on the thematic issue in a bit. But first, just want to note that this issue will be out in May 2013. It's issue 190, volume 40, number 3. I have with me two guests who will enlighten us on the contents of this issue. The first is Steve Elner. He's joining us from Venezuela. Steve has taught at the Universidad de Oriente in Puerto La Cruz, Venezuela, since 1977, and for the last 4 years has been teaching in the government-sponsored Sucre Mission Program. He's been a visiting professor at a number of universities, including Georgetown University and Universidad de Buenos Aires. His most recent book is Rethinking Venezuelan Politics, Class Polarization and the Chavez Phenomenon. He is a frequent contributor to NACLA Report on the Americas and is a participating editor of our journal, Latin American Perspectives. It's a pleasure to have you with us, Steve. Welcome.
It's my pleasure also, Armando.
And our other guest is George Ciccarello Marr. George is currently in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. He is assistant professor of political science at Drexel University and has taught previously at UC Berkeley, San Quentin State Prison, and the Venezuelan School of Planning in Caracas. His book, titled We Created Chavez, A People's History of the Venezuelan Revolution, was published last month by Duke University Press. Welcome, George. Congratulations on your new book.
Thank you, Armando. I'm glad to be here as well.
So, let us begin. This issue is very exciting because it focuses on the contemporary shifts of the Latin American left. In fact, there's a lot of discussion on two lefts that are in play in Latin America. And I'd like to go ahead and start with you, Steve, by asking you a couple of questions. The first is, can you tell me more about this binary framework used by some political analysts with regard to the 21st century political developments in Latin America?
Sure. Obviously, there is an element of truth in the two-left thesis. The radical left in power in Venezuela, Ecuador, and Bolivia is quite different in terms of their ideology, their goals, the pace of change that they favor, as opposed to more moderate left groups in Brazil, Uruguay, for instance. But the two left thesis, as developed by such writers as Jorge Castañeda in Mexico and Teodoro Petkoff in Venezuela, both of whom are writers, analysts, but also political actors, they simplify the phenomenon of the 21st century radical left. According to them, there is a good left represented by Lula, that is pitted against or contrasts with the bad left, or the populist left in the pejorative sense of the word populism, as represented by Chavez. Considerable academic literature has been published over the recent past, which argues against Castaneda's framework with the argument that both lefts are too diverse to lump in one of these two categories. This issue takes a different approach. The issue argues that regardless of the degree of similarities or diversity in the camp of the radical left in power, the challenges it faces are complex, and in some ways more complex than those facing, for instance, the communist left in power in the Soviet Union, in China, in Eastern Europe in the 20th century. The two left thesis of Castaneda, by labeling the radical left bad, or the populist, calling the left populist, fails to recognize the complexity of these challenges.
So what is the nature of the challenges?
There are three factors that can be mentioned. First, the intense polarization over an extended period of time in a democratic setting opens space for adversaries to the right to carry out legal, semi-legal, and even illegal activity. And at the same time, it opens space for political forces to the left of the radical left governments. In the second place, the heterogeneity of the movement, consisting of social groups with different and at times conflicting interests and visions, account for the complexity. And this complexity is actually compounded by the fact that the leadership of the 21st century radical left, unlike the Marxist left in power or the communist left in power in the 20th century, does not privilege any one group, such as was the case with the industrial proletariat. And in the third place, the trial and error approach of the radical left, the 21st century radical left, also generates greater debate internally than was the case with the 20th century Marxist left, based on a well-defined Marxist dogma.
So in addition to that, Steve, you did mention some of the complexities of the 21st century, but I'd like to ask, what is truly unique about the 21st century radical left movements of today?
The introductory article to the issue contrasts the 21st century radical left with four other categories of leftist movements in power. Firstly, the moderate Latin American left governments, such as those of Brazil, Uruguay, and Argentina in the present. Second, communist governments in the 20th century, such as the Soviet Union, China, Eastern Europe, etc. Three, the social democratic movements that reached power in Europe in the 20th century also. And four, radical left governments in the latter part of the 20th century in Latin America, specifically Chile under Allende and Nicaragua under the Sandinistas in the 1980s. The salient characteristics of the 21st century radical leftist governments distinguish them from other leftist governments in the other four categories I just mentioned. In the first place, intense social and political polarization over an extended period of time with an opposition that can be characterized as a disloyal opposition, disloyal in quotation marks, in the sense that in many ways that opposition refused to recognize the legitimacy of radical left governments. Two, the 21st century radical left's electoral victories have been by absolute majorities, in some cases by substantial margins, thus providing them with greater options than was the case with Allende, for instance, in Chile, who reached power with 36% of the vote in 1970. Three, high levels of ongoing mobilization over an extended period of time. Four, steady radicalization beginning with the arrival to power on the basis of relatively moderate programs, basically a political as opposed to socioeconomic change. Five, rejection of negotiations or ongoing dialogue with members of the political elite. And six, support for a Rousseau-type model of participatory democracy and support for socialism.
And for our listeners interested in the sorts of articles and arguments that this issue poses, Steve, what are some of the specific topics that the articles in this issue address?
Well, all the articles in the issue address two central related points. First, they take issue with the two left thesis, which I discussed before, which views Venezuela, Bolivia, and Ecuador as the so-called bad left or the populist left. And second, they examine different aspects of the complexity of the challenges facing radical 21st century left that I have just mentioned also. For instance, the essays by Mark Becker on Ecuador and Lorenzo Fontana on Bolivia focus on the challenges posed by social, mainly indigenous movements to the left of the Morales and Correa governments. Thomas Purcell's essay on government-promoted social production companies in Venezuela sheds light on the tension within the governing radical leftist movements between those who support efficiency and productivity, or want to emphasize efficiency and productivity, and those who defend the primacy of social objectives. The essays by Camila Pinheiro on Cuba and Hector Pirla and Hector Cruz Feliciano on Nicaragua and El Salvador, those essays discussed internal tensions within the left over different strategies, which relate not only to different ideological visions, but also conflicting interests within these leftist movements. And finally, two essays by Kevin Young and Pascal Lupien on the media in Latin America, reporting on the radical left governments in Latin America, put in evidence the fallacy stemming from the simplified interpretations of complex developments in the continent.
Thank you, Steve. Now, to provide more depth about a particular article, I'd like to now turn to George. I want to ask you a couple of questions pertaining to your article in this issue, which is titled Constituent Moments, Constitutional Processes, Social Movements and the New Latin American Left. To start with, can you tell us a bit about your article?
Sure. As Steve laid out in a sort of overarching approach to this issue, this is an article that takes issue on some level with this idea of there being two lefts in Latin America, a good left and a bad left. But what it does is it starts from one very particular perspective on that question, one that is systematically neglected by the thinkers that put forward this binary dichotomy, and that is the question of social movements and the sort of the question of popular power from below. When these thinkers talk about the bad left, and they're very critical of the bad left, they see this often in terms of policy at the very highest levels of government. And we wanted to ask, you know, how does this question play out on the level of the social movements? And as Steve also suggested, there's something very different about the bad left. And so on the one hand, we don't necessarily want to deny that there are any kind of differences between the good left and the bad left. We certainly want to refute the idea that the good is the good and the bad is the bad. And if anything, part of what we discover is that when we look at this binary from the perspective of social movements, we often find that the bad is in fact the good and the good is in fact the bad. It is more in the so-called bad left that we find social movements that actually have come closer to influencing and imposing their will on these governments. So in other words, from the perspective of constituent power from below, it is in these so-called bad regimes that the social movements have been able to have their voice heard more directly.
Okay, and you use the terms constituent moments and constitutional processes to evaluate these leftist governments. First, can you explain these terms and also explain how you use them in your article?
Sure. Constituent moments in the article I use to refer to those sort of explosive moments of rupture that sort of break open history in these countries, whether this is especially the Caracaso in Venezuela, this massive 1989 rebellion that essentially gave rise to everything that's come since, or both the indigenous struggles and urban rebellions that racked Bolivia and Ecuador, the crisis, the 2001 crisis in Argentina as well falls under these categories. These are moments where suddenly people are in the streets, suddenly the categories of struggle change, and often, depending on how these things play out, governments are overthrown, leaders are removed from power by the masses in the streets. And constituent moments is an attempt to provide a category to explain what is similar and what is different about these very powerful and important moments. And now constituent processes is what I use to refer to what in some cases then follows these moments of rupture. In other words, you know, those moments in which this rupture generates a transformation of the constitutional order, and for the most part, a rewriting of the Constitution and in the attempt to reincorporate popular power as the basis of some of these regimes.
And in your article, you focus on three specific countries. So what did you find in the cases of Bolivia, Ecuador, and Venezuela?
What I find in some way is a sort of spectrum among the so-called bad left. And I argue that it's in the case of Venezuela that for a number of reasons, not all of which have to do with the way the government has handled questions of social movements, but for a number of reasons, Venezuela has fared much better in terms of the relationship between the state and social movements. We had a situation, especially under Chavez, who was a master of mobilizing the population, mobilizing social movements, and pushing for the incorporation of these movements into the state, while also allowing these movements a great deal of autonomy to struggle, to push back against the state, to push back against especially bureaucratic apparatuses, attempting to sort of rein in their autonomy. And so you had Chavez walking what I call a fine line of allowing movements their ability to generate power, to push and to struggle, while maintaining a very friendly relationship with this developing revolutionary process within the state. Now, the issues of Bolivia and Ecuador were certainly more complex, and Bolivia is sort of an in-between case in this article. In Ecuador is really the case where I think we find Rafael Correa coming to power very much through a process that looks like what had occurred in Bolivia and had occurred in Venezuela, where there's a constituent moment of rupture, new demands are generated. One of those demands is for constitutional transformation. And we find Correa, for a number of reasons and through a number of dynamics, in some ways squandering a lot of the relations with social movements that could have developed, that had the potential to develop. So we have Correa, of course, a progressive leader, someone who's very much part of this radical left, and yet we find a much more tense relationship between the Ecuadorian state and many of the revolutionary social movements than we find, for example, in a place like Venezuela.
Thank you for that, George. Again, this article can be found in our upcoming issue titled Latin America's Radical Left in Power, Complexities and Challenges in the 21st Century. It is issue 190, volume 40, number 3. And once again, I'd like to thank our participants, both George and Steve, for taking the time to join us. For more information on this issue, visit our publisher's website at lap.sagepub.com. Also check out our website at www.latinamericanperspectives.com. Check us out on Facebook at facebook.com/LAP Journal. Thank you for being with us. Until next time.